Thank you for downloading this podcast. My name is Richard Rucroft. You're listening to Gnostic Lectures, a continuing series of lectures of Gnostic anthropology. The title of this lecture is The Three Minds. This is lecture number 11. My guest is Mr. E. Jim G. Ross.
Ladies and gentlemen, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. So allow me to talk today about the three minds. What is that, you know? What is that? In a past lecture, we spoke about the mind. And we described the mind. We said the mind is not the brain. You know, many people are totally convinced that the brain is the mind. And according to Gnostic anthropology, it is not. The brain is just a case where we construct, where we build and develop thoughts in different languages. You know, here in Toronto, Canada, we speak 200 languages. So when we create, develop an idea, the brain translates those creations into the 200 different languages. But the brain is not the mind. We explained before that the mind is an atomic body. It's a perfect representation of the physical body, but made only of atomic particles. Please remember my words. The mind is not the brain. With all respect to those who disagree with this concept. Now, why do we have three minds? Well, we are going to be developing this new approach into the study of the mind. Understanding that when people study psychology or even psychiatry, they say that the word psychology means a study of the mind. But in reality, it doesn't mean that, because the mind, psychology is a Greek word. It means psychis, means soul, and logos is a study. Psychology means really a study of the soul. And some people say, well, it is the same. No, it's not the same. With all respect, it is not the same. The soul is higher than the mind. The soul is the bridge between the spirit, our real being, God within, that little spark that lives in our heart, that descended from the absolute, the kingdom of God. And the soul is then the bridge between our divine spirit, our real being, and the mind and the body. So that's the soul. So psychology means really the study of the soul, the study of consciousness, because soul means consciousness in a more modern language, more modern translation. Soul is a religious word, a religious concept. And we study in past lectures also the ego, remember? The ego is the me. Instead of believing that we are all important, the ego is telling us that I'm more important than anybody else, which is wrong, because history, human history, has proven that egotistic societies, egotistic individuals, have created more pain on earth than anything else. As we said before, the ego is the cause of wars, conflicts, violence, crime, poverty, hunger in the world, all kind of human tragedies. So do we need the ego then? Well, many people are convinced that we need the ego. The ego is subconscious, unconscious, infraconscious, the same deadly sins of Christianity. All religions speak about the ego. We explained that before. I don't think we need to repeat what we said before. But if it is subconscious, unconscious, infraconscious, don't you feel that we need to be conscious about reality to perceive reality the way it is? So that would allow us to create paradise on earth instead of what we've done. Do you believe this is paradise on earth right now? Don't you feel that some part of the world are immersed within pure, pure inferno? Children that were born to die because of hunger, wars, children of war, you need all kind of tragedies. global catastrophes. Do you believe that this is paradise on earth? Of course not. But if we are able to annihilate the ego, and this is exactly what Jesus Christ and all prophets before and after came to teach us, annihilate the ego, then we can create a stronger soul. Right now, Gnostic anthropology teaches us that we are 97% ego and 3% soul, 3% consciousness. So we are unconscious, 97%. Do you believe we can function properly with only 97% sleeping 24 hours a day? Of course not. You know, look at our scientific world. Everything that we consider a discovery, something that we are going to share with humanity, it is not based on consciousness. It is based on a subconscious perception of reality. You know, look at medical laboratories. Every 3 years, they replace a medicine. Why? Because it was never good. And the new one that they is replacing the older ones, is it also going to be better? Sometimes it's even worse. It creates new illnesses, new problems. Why? Again, because what we call the scientific perception of reality, it is not. Everything is based on hypothesis. A hypothesis is a truth to be verified, to be tested, to be proven. And this is why, you know, our degree of perception of reality is so low that we live from conflict into conflict, problem into problem, failure after failure. Do we like to live in a state of constant failure? Look at the political world. Look at the state of war everywhere. Conflicts everywhere. Social, economic, political conflicts. Come on, you know. Isn't it time to stop that? Because if we don't stop it, we are committing collective suicide. Is it that we want for our planet Earth? For our so-called human society? We are not even a society. Society means we are all partners. Are we really partners? Come on, we are not. We are not. So the time has come then to understand clearly what's a true psychology. Gnostic psychology teaches us to be more realistic about reality. This is why when we study the mind, we say we have more than a mind. Why do we say that? Because the ego is not one entity. The ego is 100, 1,000, 10,000, 100,000 different eyes, different identities. Well, if we say 10,000, we're not sure, we're not too much. This is approximately the amount of different eyes that we carry within. We are maybe aware of some eyes, our defects, our vices, our errors, our perversities. You see, sometimes we act in a wrong way and we don't even realize it. So these different eyes, they are different entities which are alive within ourselves. And they enter into conflict. You know, they are struggling within each other. This is why every little eye possesses a different mind. Can you imagine 10,000 different minds struggling with each other within ourselves? Of course we are in troubles. What do you expect? Who created the ego? We did it because of a wrong perception of reality, because we disobeyed cosmic laws that were given to us in ancient religions. Moses, you know, gave us the Ten Commandments. Who is listening to them? Who is practicing to them? Not even people who are supposed to be followers of Moses. You know, what about Christianity? Jesus Christ was teaching us. People who call themselves Christians or Catholic. Are we really what we say we are? Indian, the Hindu religion, etc., etc. So the time has come, you know, to realize who we are. How can we correct our mistakes? How to be able to awaken our soul, our consciousness? How can we be able to rebuild our soul, our consciousness? By learning to annihilate the ego, then we have to study the mind. Because the same way the soul is possessed by the ego, the soul has been infiltrated by the ego, the mind also. The mind also has been infiltrated and dominated by the ego. This is why our thoughts are twisted thoughts that don't represent reality the way it is. We don't see reality the way it is. We see a twisted reality. So as we said, then if we have 10,000 thoughts, how can we organize a proper study of our mind? Okay, let's divide now these 10,000 different minds into three kind of minds. Let's organize now better. Then we can understand ourselves better. You know, Jesus Christ is in the Bible. He described, if you remember, he said, we need new containers for a new wine. What is that, you know? Most of people memorize the Bible, they repeat it, like, you know, parrots, with all respect, without understanding what they are reading. And their interpretation, of course, according to our twisted minds, won't be very much correct. Gnostic anthropology brings us a more proper interpretation. We could say the new container represents to be able to build a new mind, a fresh new mind, actually a mind without ego, because God, the divinity, gave us a mind without ego. We created the ego when we stopped listening to cosmic law, when we disobeyed the law, divine law. This is the real mind, the inner mind. But then we created additional minds, as we said, 10,000 different minds that can be restructured, that can be understood into two other kind of minds. And Jesus Christ explained about that. He spoke about the Pharisees, remember that, the Pharisees, and the Sadducees. Do you remember that? What is that? He said the Pharisees are those who prayed loudly to be seen as holy people. But in reality, he says, they look like whitened sepulchres, whitened outside in the cemeteries, but rotten inside. They are the same fanatic people today who speak loudly about God. And sometimes they provoke all kinds of wars because of fanatic attitude. And all religion, without exception, have fallen into that kind of tendency. And these people pretend, or they are convinced, that they are holy individuals when they are not. And the other perception of this kind of mind is the opposite. The atheist perception of the divinity, the Sadducees, people who, listen to this carefully, people who only believe that the divinity has no reality. They cannot prove it. They only believe it. And they become convinced that they are more intelligent than the others. So at the end, we have a conflict between these two tendencies, a materialistic perception of reality and an extreme spiritual perception of reality, and they enter into conflict. And they forget to be realistic, because real reality is that the spirit and matter both are part of reality. In Gnostic anthropology, we study both. We say we are a spirit and we have a body and a mind and a soul. So they are vehicles of the spirit, but both are important. Both have a mission together, to work together. So this is why the Pharisees and the Sadducees, two different kind of minds, are twisted perception of reality. What we need is a more realistic approach, which is coming back into the beginning, what God gave us, the inner mind. Now, in a more modern perception of reality, we could say the Pharisees are, we can call it a mind which is intermediate between the real mind and the materialistic mind, or the atheist mind. And the other mind, the Sadducees, we can call it the sensual mind, because it is based on the five senses. People say, I don't believe it if I don't see it. Can we see an atomic particle? Can we see an atom? We cannot. Can we see the air? We cannot. But it's there. You see, there are many things that we cannot see. Can we see the spirit? Of course not. So the situation is our five senses are so limited to perceive reality that, of course, if we develop the sensual mind, we will fall into mistake after mistake after mistake. Wrongdoing after wrongdoing after wrongdoing. And then the problem is we become convinced that this is the way it should be, ignoring the other aspect of the universe, which is the spiritual part. But on the other side, people who convince themselves that they are spiritual, these are the people who believe in God, but believing is not enough. Why is it is not enough? Because I have met people who were very religious, and they experienced a war, and I met them 20 years later. And because of the suffering product of the war, they don't believe anymore. They say there is no God. So to believe or not to believe is a very weak perception of reality. And I met other kind of people who didn't believe in the divinity. And 20 years later, because of the same war, well, now they do believe. But that's very fragile. To believe or not to believe is extremely fragile. You see the point? So this mind, the Pharisee and the Sadducee, these two types of mind, which are extremes, they are very weak and very twisted because they are very incomplete about their perception of reality. You see the problem. So the time has come to understand that we need now to come back to the beginning, to the original mind that was given to us by the divinity. You know, we were talking today, Rick, with the psychology of a child, you know, when children are 5 years of age and they always tell the truth because they haven't developed the ego yet. Normally, when we become 7 years of age, we develop the ego, the subconscious perception of reality. And of course, we become twisted. We learn to lie. But when you are a child, 3 years of age, you're beginning to talk. 5 years of age, you tell the truth. Because the way you perceive reality is more complete. You see the situation. Their mind is not contaminated by the ego. They don't have a Pharisee mind. They don't have a Sadducee mind. They don't have a sensual mind based on the five senses. And they don't have an intermediate or Pharisee mind. They are very much connected with their inner mind. Listen to this carefully. And this inner mind, which is the real mind, has to be rebuilt, has to be reconstructed. Why? Because it's already ignored, it's already destroyed, it's already amputated by its own natural qualities. So we have to recreate it. Because it's there. The spirit of the mind is always there. The real mind, the true mind, the inner mind is there. It's a gift from heaven. And that real mind will reappear, will be recreated, rebuilt, because it's more real than all realities, will be rebuilt when the ego dies, when the ego disappears, when we learn to annihilate the seven deadly sins through meditation, in a constant dialogue with God, with the divinity. So, if we begin the work now, today, every day, with our inner mind, it means we have to learn to meditate. Meditation. What is meditation? People confuse meditation with prayer, praying. You know, praying is begging for help to the divinity. God, give me the energy, give me the strength to do this, to get there. But meditation is more than that. Meditation is establishing a dialogue with the divinity, asking questions and listening to the answers from the divinity. But how can we do that? How can we do it? There is one way. Learning to shut up. Listen to this carefully. Learning to quiet, to shut up the inferior minds. The 10,000 different minds synthesized in these two inferior minds. Unrealistic minds. The sensual mind of the atheist people and the intermediate mind of the fanatic religious individuals. So the mind has to be quiet. Don't create any thought. Control your brain. Block your brain. There are many ways to do that. You know, in the near future, we will give you some techniques to learn to meditate. But in the meantime, what we are giving you is a vision, a perception of what we should do every day to understand that we new container for a new wine means we have to change our way of thinking. Listen to this. We have to learn to change our way of thinking because the mind has to be able to connect with the spirit, with God, with the divinity, with wisdom itself, with love, real love itself, with consciousness itself. And as we said, that consciousness is the soul, is the bridge between the spirit, God, the divinity, and the mind. So we need to recreate our soul, which is already abused and controlled and ruled and infiltrated by the ego. The ego is the same Satan of all religions. Don't be afraid of the word, because this is exactly what it means, you know. The ego, because doesn't perceive reality the way it is. It's a subconscious perception of reality, makes mistake after mistake. And mistake will lead us inevitable into pain, suffering, tragedy after tragedy. So it's up to us. Do we enjoy suffering? Well, if we do, don't cry after. So it's very important to learn again to quiet the mind. We have to learn to develop our creative willpower. We have to learn to dominate our mind. When we dominate the mind and we learn to quiet the mind, we will learn to experience, you know, the power of silence. The silence of the mind, listen to this, the silence of the mind will avoid the constant struggle of these 10,000 little eyes, little, we can even call them little demons that live inside of our mind, who struggle with each other. And the noise that they produce will block our capability to concentrate, will block our capability to connect with the divinity. So when the mind is silent, we can listen to the inner voice of the divinity. This is extremely important. This is why people who have learned to meditate, they can establish a relationship with God within, with the divinity within. And the divinity means wisdom, true consciousness, objective consciousness, and true love. You see? And that way we make no mistakes or less mistakes while we're learning to become realistic, to perceive reality the way it is. So this is extremely important, to rebuild our inner mind, to rebuild our inner mind, which is already imprisoned within the ego and ruled by twisted minds that are product of the ego, of the me, and I don't care about anybody else. And of course, this is a wrong psychology. This is a wrong perception of reality, because history has proven that the ego, again, has created only problem after problem after problem, pain after pain after pain. It's important that we are able to remember that we need to understand that we have to change our way of thinking, and we have to learn that the inner mind given to us by the divinity is the real mind that will allow us to bring happiness on earth again, the way it used to be, when earth was a paradise, and we can rebuild a new true society where we are all partners within our planet Earth. Is it possible? Yes, it is. It's up to us. We are the ones who are failing to commit, you know, to that possibility. It's up to us. Now, on the other side, Mother Nature, well, will do the job. Why so many catastrophes everywhere? Because, you know, we are being rejected by Mother Nature. And if we really want to cooperate with Mother Nature, we should be able to interconnect with the divinity, to establish a perfect relationship with the Holy Spirit and Mother Nature with the wife of the Holy Spirit, you see, and then we can ascend within the Jacob ladder, which is developing our level of being. In our past lecture, number 10, we spoke about the level of being. So the vertical line, the time has come to move up within the vertical line. We are learning to be. Then we can have a better existence. We can learn to have an existence superior to the one we have today, but we have to learn to be first, learning to be. So the three minds are number one, the inner mind, number two, the materialistic Sadducee mind, we can call it the sensual mind, based on the five senses, which are very incomplete, and ignoring that we have superior senses, we have more senses than the five senses. And this because they are, you know, in a stage of degeneration, we haven't been able to develop those superior senses. And the other mind is the intermediate mind, or the Pharisee mind, or the fanatic religious mind that creates more conflict than anything else. And when we created the ego, we developed the ego infiltrated the mind. And as we said, there are 10,000 different minds inside of us fighting with each other, but we can synthesize the 10,000 minds into two different groups. They are inferior mind ruled by the ego. The Sadducee and the Pharisee, or the sensual mind and the intermediate mind. But the real mind, the inner mind, is not there anymore. And people live a life without realizing that inner mind has always been there, will always be, but we destroyed our own, you know, gift from heaven by disobeying cosmic law. The black magicians use they manipulate everything, but in reality, most of them are fanatic religious, the black magician, because they do rituals, you know. They invoke entities from the universe, and they believe those entities are angels, and they are not. They are evil entities. So the black magicians are, we could say, religious, but the wrong way, the twisted way. And the other people, the materialistic individual, the atheist, they don't believe in rituals. Normally, they are very, you know, skeptical, you know, about these kind of things. But they are just pragmatic, you know. They don't believe in the divinity. They don't believe, they have no respect for nature. They believe nature is lower than we are. Nature had to be enslaved, according to them, you know. This is why they do all kind of experiments, like nuclear experiments, because they believe it's okay to do it. The mind is a body. The mind is an atomic body, a replica of the physical body, but it's not cellular, it's only atomic. And this body moves around, that is not imprisoned within the physical body. That mind was given to us in ancient time, before the physical Earth existed. Remember that there was the history of the planet Earth. The first planet Earth was atomic. Then we were given a mental body. It's a body, it's an organism. The brain is only a case to create thoughts in different languages. That's it. It's a computer. Thinking is the animal soul. Animals are evolving into a similar stage to our, but lower. they are not intellectual anymore, but they are developing the capacity of thinking. They are developing language themselves, and this is what we call thinking. But the superior mind, the real mind, doesn't need to think. It's connected with the pineal gland and the pituitary gland. So inspiration is here in the pineal gland and creates willpower. And then we receive from the universe, through our pineal gland, all the information that we need to capture. Geniuses like Albert Einstein did that, you know, to discover, to develop, you know, the relativity of time and space. And also imagination. And he said, everything we can imagine has reality in the universe. And we can go as far as we can imagine, because imagination is clairvoyance itself. You see, this is the real mind, the inner mind. And the inner mind can connect with the inner intelligence, either emotion, the inner emotional intelligence, which is intuition. This is why Samael says the path of initiation is inspiration, imagination, intuition. That's it. And this is the age of intuition now. So we have to learn to awaken intuition. So it's very, very important to understand, to clarify better, you know, what's the inner mind. You know, the inner mind doesn't need to think. That's because thinking, what is thinking? Isn't it the struggle of the antithesis? What is that? The battlefield between yes, 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 no, 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 or a thesis against an antithesis. What is the synthesis? Listen to this. So the synthesis will be wrong if the thesis is wrong. You see, and people call it, the scientific world call it, the scientific logic, the scientific method to perceive reality. And the problem is because they haven't developed the inner mind, they need to get into the process of thinking, the struggle of the antithesis. You see? And the struggle of the antithesis will take us nowhere. We won't be able to discover reality the way it is. So the inner mind is connected with the pineal gland on the crown of the head and the pituitary gland. So the pineal gland carries within the capability of inspiration, which is a capability for all of us, but not developed. You see, but if we are here, it's a gift from heaven that we have to learn to develop. Inspiration is inhaling from the universe through our crown in the top of our head, inhaling knowledge given to us by the sun and the stars. Mother Nature and the divinity will give us all the information that we need to perceive. Remember that if you are inspired, you can inspire other people. Albert Einstein developed his perception of, his interpretation of relativity of time and space through inspiration. He didn't get there through thinking. You see, but the pineal gland is also connected with creative willpower. Creative willpower opposite to bad will. Many people have willpower but negatively developed. You know, bad will, when people are stubborn, they believe they know it all when they don't. But creative willpower is putting all your life, all your senses, all your potential before the truth. Exploring reality, trying to find the truth, the true reality of all realities, which is the absolute, which is the divinity. Our real being, remember, with a little piece of God. So inspiration and creative willpower come from the pineal gland that has to be re-energized. And we will tell you later how can we get there. But mainly when you learn to quiet the mind, when you stop thinking, then we can awaken inspiration and creative willpower. What about the pituitary gland, another endocrine gland connected with the seven endocrine system? The pituitary gland is called the third eye. Well, that's creative imagination, opposite to mechanical imagination. What is mechanical imagination? Everybody has mechanical imagination. It's a photocopy machine. You know, people copy other people's ideas. They don't have their own ideas. And this is the tragedy today. People speak about imagination and they underestimate the meaning of imagination because they say, oh yeah, it's only an imagination, which is an illusion. But they don't realize that there is a true creative imagination, which is clairvoyance itself. It's being able to perceive reality without being there. Albert Einstein used to say, everything we can imagine has reality. If we can imagine that we can travel out of the galaxy one day in a spaceship, it is possible because it's a perception of reality without being there. You see, so inspiration, creative willpower, and creative imagination are superior senses, higher than the five limited senses that we already have, not even developed, because animals can smell before than we do. Animals can hear sounds before than we do. So where is the big deal of the five senses that materialistic scientists, individuals, believe is their highest of the highest within themselves? When we develop the superior intellect, which is inspiration, creative imagination, and creative willpower, we can establish then a connection with the inner mind and the inner emotional intelligence, which is allocated in our heart, which is intuition. Intuition is a superior sense. Intuition will develop also when we learn to shut up the mind, the inferior mind, the two inferior minds. When we stop thinking, the voice of silence will talk to us. God speaks with the voice of silence. So, listen to this carefully. Thinking is not a big deal, ladies and gentlemen. When we've been told that thinking and thinking and thinking makes us more intelligent, with all respect, Gnostic anthropology teaches us we're wrong. The world has been thinking and thinking and thinking for centuries. Who developed the concept of logic wasn't Aristoteles, the Greek philosopher. Well, he did a good job at his time. He lived before Jesus Christ. And that was good because at that particular historic moment, humanity was very much instinctive. People didn't like to think. People were instinctive. People jumped into the battlefield carrying heavy, you know, weapons that they had to develop muscles to carry them, you know, a heavy armor. And of course, they were very instinctive. The instinct is also something that we have lost already. You know, we are walking on the street and a car is coming and suddenly we are facing death. We think we are dead because thinking is a very slow process. When you have the instinct developed, if the car is going to hit you and you need only a half of a second to survive, your body will move faster than thinking and you won't be killed. You see? The instinct capability has been lost. But there was a moment that we needed to develop the capability of thinking. So this Greek philosopher, Aristoteles, did a good job 2,000, 3,000 years ago. But today, our entire solar system is traveling within the galaxy. We enter into the constellation of Aquarius. And this is the Aquarian Age. And the Aquarian Age has produced a shift, a complete shift within our planet Earth and the entire solar system. So now the time has come to develop emotional intelligence and, of course, the superior intellect, the inner mind. Well, emotional intelligence is connected with intuition coming from the heart. So this is the age of intuition today. But the age of intuition will help us to bring back our true intellectual intelligence that doesn't come from thinking. It comes from the inner mind, which is inspiration, imagination, and creative willpower. Perceiving reality. Listen to this. Perceiving reality without thinking. After we have, listen to this carefully. After we have perceived reality through inspiration, through imagination, and through intuition, then we are allowed to think. Because our thought will be mathematically correct. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? The universe has been created through mathematics and music, sound and mathematics. Well, the thoughts will be perfectly correct, mathematically speaking, regarding the perception of reality, only we can learn to stop the process of thinking in the air, the way we do it today. Developing a hypothesis after hypothesis, just doing experiments with ourselves without knowing what we are doing. But when we listen first to our inspiration, our imagination, and our intuition, then we are allowed to think, because those thoughts will be based substantially in something more solid than just doing experiments without a fundamental base. I hope we can understand each other. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you for downloading this podcast. My name is Richard Rucroft. You're listening to Gnostic Lectures, a continuing series of lectures of Gnostic anthropology. The title of this lecture is The Three Minds. This is lecture number 11. My guest is Mr. E. Jim G. Roth. Thank you very much.